No Chinese girl had the right to marry until the emperor rejected her. It was believed that a woman possessed a magical power that flowed from her during intercourse and made the man immortal. As a result, the emperor's harem was incredibly huge. At different times, it housed up to 40,000 women. But why did parents disfigure their daughters to prevent them from entering the harem? What notions of beauty from that time would shock you? Why did a lady sit in the emperor's bedroom, recording everything that happened in his bed? What customs of the Chinese harem would shock you? So, meet our heroine, the last great ruler of the Qing dynasty, Empress Dowager Cixi, about whom legends abound. Let's go back to the time when she was still a teenager. Her name was Little Orchid. She came from a noble but poor Manchu family. Her father was an official. Little Orchid was in love and engaged to a handsome young man. They spent all their time together. But then a new emperor, Xian Feng, ascended the throne, and according to tradition, concubines were sought throughout the empire for him. Little Orchid, as the daughter of a Manchu official, was obligated by her parents to be registered as a candidate for the harem. They faced severe punishment if they married off their daughter without the emperor's rejection. Those were the rules. And so Little Orchid was sent to Beijing. All women in ancient China were essentially concubines. The huge harem of the Chinese emperor was not intended for mere pleasure or procreation. In China, where everything was infused with a special Eastern philosophy, matters of sex were complex. The emperor was the divine son of heaven, and his intimate life was incredibly important for the entire country. It was subject to strict regulations aimed at maintaining the balance of masculine energy, yang, and feminine energy, yin, in his body. If yin outweighed yang and the emperor's potency weakened, he began to age, which in turn threatened China with catastrophes related to water, floods, early frosts, and even military conflicts. Moreover, Chinese sages considered a woman to be a source of magical life force that made a man immortal. This energy flowed during sex. Therefore, it was crucial for the emperor to have many concubines. Sexuality permeated all aspects of Chinese culture in ancient times. In special treatises, Taoist sages described the art of the bedroom as they called the science of love. They explained how much and how often one should make love for a man to rejuvenate. The status of each harem resident depended on her yin energy. Of course, the empress possessed the highest energy. However, her yin energy was limited, so the emperor could only have intimate contact with her once a month to produce strong and intelligent heirs. But with other harem residents, the son of heaven had the right to be more frequent in bed. The lower the rank of the concubine, the more often she could engage in this. Let's return to Little Orchid. The selection of candidates was conducted by a special chamber of important affairs. Other contenders called our heroine Bigfooted Ugly and believed she had no chance of entering the harem. The thing was, purebred Chinese girls had their feet bound from infancy. Their foot bones were broken, and then their toes were wrapped around the foot. Such tiny feet were called golden lotuses. The smaller the foot, the more prestigious and beautiful it was considered. Girls were proud of their lotus feet, but in reality, they became disabled. They couldn't even move independently. In my humble opinion, such sacrifices for beauty are not justified. What do you think? Write in the comments. Among the Manchus, to whom our heroine belonged, girls' feet were not bound, and she had perfectly normal feet. Little Orchid missed her beloved deeply and hoped to return to him soon. Can you imagine how she felt when she found out she had passed the selection? After that, neither she nor her parents could do anything. At worst, she would have been taken by force. In 1852, she was given the name Cixi and entered the gates of the Forbidden City. She was assigned the lowest rank among the concubines, the fifth. Fifth-rank concubines were called precious people. However, despite this poetic name, they were ordinary servants. It was their duty to serve the concubines of higher ranks. And Cixi had no chance of even seeing the emperor, let alone being in his bed. Understanding the emperor's harem and its ranks is very difficult. It's not like the sultan and his concubines of the Ottoman Empire. No, it's much more complex, with a strict system governing everything. The emperor had four wives not just because he liked the number, no, they symbolized the four cardinal directions and the four seasons. Together with the Son of Heaven, they formed the sacred number five, five elements, five colors, five tastes, and so on. From this perspective, the imperial harem represented a microcosm of the universe. According to a later and more extravagant interpretation, the imperial family should resemble a tea set, where one teapot is accompanied by several cups. That's how it was. Could you endure such a life? However, the wise Emperor Shun had only three wives. After all, 3 times 3 make 9 the peak of male strength, yang, so that's also a good number. The number of imperial wives during the Xia dynasty was supposed to be 12, 4 times 3. During the Shang and Zhou dynasties, the number of the emperor's wives and concubines increased to 39, and again, not without reason. This number was explained by the fact that a woman's life ends at 40. During the Qing dynasty, besides the empress, the emperor could have one imperial noble consort, 2 noble consorts, 4 regular consorts, 6 imperial concubines, as well as noble ladies, first-class maids, second-class maids, and attendants. And this was one of the simplest systems of harem division in Chinese history. During the Song dynasty, there were 18 ranks of imperial concubines, the lady of highest ceremony, the lady of noble ceremony, the lady of favorable appearance, the lady of graceful appearance, the lady of bright manners, the lady of radiant countenance, and so forth. During the Zhou dynasty, the number of ladies in the harem increased to 120. Each of them was entitled to a palace residence, their own servants, and eunuchs. The number of servants also depended on their personal rank. The empress was served by 12 maids, first-rank concubines by 8, while common ones had only 2. They all lived together. During the Tang and Ming dynasties, their number reached up to 40,000 women. In the harem, concubines had to maintain their appearance daily. After all, they had to be ready for the emperor's call at any moment. Complex makeup and intricate hairstyles required a lot of patience from them. In the celestial kingdom, it was demanded that the ladies' figures shine with the harmony of straight lines. For this, from the age of 10, girls were made to bind their chests with a special band or even a vest. This prevented breast development and severely limited chest mobility and, consequently, the body's oxygen supply. It did not add to their health. Ladies also shaved part of their hairline to elongate the oval of their faces and achieved perfect lip contours by applying lipstick. Etiquette dictated that a woman's face should always be expressionless and her movements restrained and smooth. In paintings, we see that the ideal of beauty is incredibly delicate girls. Writer Liu wrote, "It is known that in our world there are 2 categories of women. One is the type that people usually only admire, and the other is the type that people enjoy. That's why the beauties we usually admire in paintings by artists are invariably fragile, petite, and very graceful. You will never encounter voluptuous or overly full-bodied beauties. Why, you may ask? Because these delicate and graceful women are created solely for admiration. Alas, they are not suitable for enjoyment." But Cixi decided to survive in the harem. For this, she avidly read books from the imperial library and persuaded the courtiers to hire teachers for her. She mastered the incredibly complex etiquette of the Forbidden City to perfection. In 4 years of living in the harem, Cixi was able to elevate her rank to the third, and most importantly, she managed to become friends with the Empress Dowager Qian by recognizing poison in her cup. Or perhaps it was Cixi's cunning plan. The young emperor was indifferent to Qian, who could not bear him a son. The concubines who knew about this fought desperately to attract his attention. The empress was strictly forbidden to be jealous of her husband the emperor's attention to the harem residence. Doctors said that jealousy drained a woman, causing constant leakage of her female essence and energy from her secret chambers. And there was no one to be jealous of. In China, everything was meticulously recorded. The names of those lucky enough to be honored with the high privilege of sharing the Son of Heaven's bed were recorded in a special book by eunuchs, significantly increasing their rank. These books also recorded all the details of what happened in the emperor's bedroom. Such thoroughness. Eunuchs brought concubines to the emperor's bedroom, but he went to his wife himself. If the time spent with a concubine in the bedroom was strictly limited, he could spend the whole night with the empress. But even this visit was meticulously recorded by a eunuch in a special book. He awaited the emperor's response regarding whether the act of love had taken place, and recorded everything. The emperor himself was also bound by strict palace etiquette. Even the number of his sexual encounters was regulated. Every 5 days, the emperor was obligated to summon a concubine, and only the death of his parents or mourning exempted him from this duty for 3 months. Being friends with the empress was a very astute move on Cixi's part. When the emperor offered his wife the choice of selecting a concubine who would bear him an heir in her place, she, of course, chose her friend. And now brace yourself. In ancient times, the emperor and his concubines were not alone in the bedroom. In his youth, the heavenly son's actions could be closely monitored by his mother, who would immediately give advice on how to fulfill marital duties correctly. In today's reality, it's hard to imagine a mother's presence during such an intimate process. However, many women to this day cannot refrain from interfering in their children's personal lives. Apparently, this behavior has deep roots in ancient times, don't you think? Peeping was also popular in the harem. It was believed that observing intercourse also provided an opportunity to gain the lover's energy. For those who couldn't wait for their turn, voyeurism replaced the act itself, and for newcomers, it was a lesson. There were special court ladies who kept records of the imperial couplings to confirm the legitimacy of children. For example, during the reign of the Shang ruler Zhou Xing, there was a chair in his chambers for such a lady. She sat there and closely observed what happened in bed between the emperor and his concubine, then meticulously recorded all the details. In later times, this task was taken over by palace eunuchs. Now the Son of Heaven would choose a concubine for the night like this. He would draw a jade tablet with the number or name of the concubine from a special dragon-shaped box, and then find her image in an album using the number. The harem was a real labyrinth. Being a virgin was considered a real disgrace here, so concubines fought as best they could for the right to spend the night with the emperor. Some would persuade artists to portray them more favorably, while they'd request their beautiful competitors to be depicted less attractively. In general, the emperor would take out the tablet, strike the gong, and hand it over to the duty eunuch, who would then note in a special journal whom the emperor had chosen. Cixi was chosen by the empress. They sent for her, stripped her naked so she couldn't conceal any weapons, washed her, and anointed her with fragrances. Then a eunuch wrapped the naked Cixi in a hair and feather cloak and carried her on his back to the Son of Heaven's chambers. There, he removed the cloak from her. The emperor was already in bed, and Cixi slipped under the covers with him. The Son of Heaven's bed was much more than just a bed. It was more like a small room with four columns. While the son of heaven was coupling with his concubine, in the neighboring room, a eunuch and the chief manager of the important affairs of the palace awaited. They made sure the concubine didn't linger too long. And when it was time for her to leave, the chief manager would shout, "Time's up." On the third time, the emperor responded. The chief manager entered the bedroom, knelt down, and asked, "To leave or stay?" This referred to the precious dragon seed. And the emperor ordered her to stay. The eunuch would then register it. This was how the legitimacy of a child's birth by the emperor was determined. Afterward, the eunuch wrapped Cixi back in the cloak and carried her away. Cixi, like everyone who had been in the emperor's bed, had a special seal rubbed onto her palms, which was done with cinnamon. This seal lasted forever, but its absence was considered a disgrace. Concubines were willing to do anything to become the mother of the heir to the throne and occupy the highest position in the harem. Intrigue, lies, collusion with eunuchs, bribing them, and even murdering rivals were all part of the harem's ruthless order. Being beautiful in that era in China was more of a punishment. The customs in Chinese harems filled parents of daughters with such horror that they often preferred to disfigure their children so they wouldn't be taken as concubines. They would cut the skin above their eyebrows or mouth so scars would appear. After that, they wouldn't be accepted into the harem. But getting married would still be an option. You might ask, how could parents do that? They understood perfectly well that surviving in the harem was much harder than getting in. And life in this gilded cage was far from ideal. Or would you have acted differently? Prince Jian was a true sadist. For the slightest transgressions, he made concubines sit naked on trees or starved them to death. He became infamous for his cruelty to the Shijun concubines. He tortured the poor girls so much that in 1542, driven to despair, they decided to kill him. Of course, the assassination attempt failed. The poor girls were captured, tortured, and executed. As for our heroine, she rose to the rank of precious concubines, becoming the second, next to the empress. Her position was further solidified when she bore the emperor and heir to the throne. However, Cixi's son was immediately taken away from her after birth by Empress Qian. She raised him herself. And once again, our heroine lost the one she loved. But she managed to win the heart of the emperor. He gradually appreciated her knowledge and entrusted her with more and more authority, making her effectively the ruler of China. Over time, former friends became enemies. Qian was afraid that Cixi skillfully and ruthlessly disposed of other concubines of the emperor, rightfully fearing for her own life. After the emperor's death, Cixi's son, Zaichuan, ascended the throne. Both Cixi and Qian were appointed as widowed empresses and regents. After Qian's death, the widowed empress Cixi became the sole regent. She ruled China for half a century. This period was filled with bloody struggles for power. She suppressed several rebellions and lost several wars. Cixi was cruel and ruthless to anyone who could threaten her power. She was also a symbol of endless ambition and cruelty, abnormal even for an average human being. The question is, what turned the little orchid into the sadist and tyrant Cixi? Why, in your opinion, did she become like that? What events in her life could have led to such a transformation? Share your thoughts. Nevertheless, it was Cixi who banned the binding of girls' feet for the sake of golden lotus feet and making them cripples. She abolished the torturous corporal punishment. Cixi granted women the right to education and work. When her son died, she made her 4-year-old nephew emperor and continued to rule the country. The last thing she did before her death was to introduce universal suffrage. The Chinese monarchy survived the empress only briefly. In 1911, the Qing dynasty was overthrown after the Xinhai Revolution. Don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss new videos. Until next time.